Okay, thank you very much for the invitation to give this introductory lecture on resurgence. I'm very happy to be here. It's a big honor, and it's also very impressive to be here in front of some of the founders of this topic, like André, who is here. So I will try to do my best. So let me start with a small introduction, because my lecture will be quite introductory, because resurgence addresses very basic questions in physics. And the main question that you can start formulating in order to understand what resurgence is about is the meaning of perturbation theory in quantum physics. Okay, so let me start with a very simple example, which actually was a kind of historically very important, which is the perturbation theory for the quartic, the anharmonic oscillator. So this is actually a basic problem in quantum mechanics that you can find in many textbooks, and maybe many of you study this as an undergrad student. So you consider the following Hamiltonian, which is a harmonic oscillator, standard harmonic oscillator, perturbed by a quartic term and with a coupling constant G, which we are going to take positive. And you ask yourself the question of what can you say about the spectral properties of this Hamiltonian. So if you want, there are some exact results that you can write. And this is what we are going to call, what I'm going to call in this talk, non-perturbative definition, because this type of results do not rely at all on any perturbative scheme. So,
by the way, when you write these things, do you assume that Planck constant is fixed, has a fixed value, or?
Yeah. Well, here, that Q and P is, it's part of the data. Okay. Yeah, it's just going to. I'm not going to do perturbation theory in H bar here. I'm going to do mostly perturbation theory in G here, but later on we will do perturbation theory in H bar. So. So one thing you know is that if G is positive, you know, this is a confining potential. And if you want, you know that this operator, the inverse of this Hamiltonian, is a compact operator. And then you know that there is a discrete spectrum. So a spectral theory guarantees you that there will be a series of eigenvalues for this Hamiltonian, which depends on G. So you will have a ground state energy, a first set state energy, and so on. So this is a quite elementary problem. And if you want to calculate, for example, the ground state energy, you can always do it numerically. Now, so this is, if you want, the exact result. But then you can also do perturbation theory. So what perturbation theory? So this is one of the standard tools in quantum theory. You know that this Hamiltonian, when G is equal to 0, is exactly solvable. And you try to find some sort of formal power series in G to describe this spectrum. So what you actually find when you do perturbation theory is actually a formal power series. I'm going to call it like phi. This is a purely formal power series, which has this form, where A0 is 1/2. So I'm going to put H bar equal to 1, just to avoid normalizations. And you know, you can actually write this series. You can amuse yourself to compute this series. And you have something like this. And what you know is that this series, you know well, but you know many things about this series. The first thing you know is that this series is divergent. And actually, the degree of divergence can be quantified very precisely. These coefficients, an, actually diverge factorially. So they go like n factorial times 3/4 to the n times minus 1 to the n. So this is a result that can be established in many different ways. Actually, one of the applications of resurgence is to establish this result. But right now, what I want to emphasize is that this is not only, this is really a formal power series, because it's asymptotically gross factorially, so it's divergent. And what we know then is that the ground state energy which is a well-defined function by this spectral problem, has an asymptotic expansion E I phi zero G. So here we have two different worlds. We have the world of exact results, where we have this sort of function of G, and then we have the world of asymptotic power series, and we know that they are related by an asymptotic relationship in the sense of Poincaré. Okay, so this is all very standard, but now
the G, you said the G is positive, so
yes.
G greater than 1 also, otherwise...
What?
No, both positive.
Yeah, but G is positive, yeah? So what
yeah, no, G is greater than 0,
yes.
And you said the final G is also divergent.
Sorry?
This series is also
yeah,
this series.
Yeah.
So
yes.
If G is less than 1, or G can be less than 1?
No, this is actually very for any positive value G. Because it's factorially divergent.
So if G is less than 1, can you say always that it diverges?
Yes, it's divergent for any positive value of G. Okay, but it has zero radius of convergence for any value of G. That's why if there was no this factorial, there will be a finite radius of convergence. But there is a factorial, so this is divergent for any positive value of G. Any G different from 0 gives you, positive G different from 0 gives you. So this series forma process has zero radius of convergence. So the question, one of the questions you can ask is the following. Okay, we know that there is this asymptotic relationship, but is it possible to reconstruct this exact result from the knowledge of this perturbative series? That's one of the questions we would like to know. The other question you could ask is, how would you make sense of this asymptotic series? And these questions in quantum mechanics are relatively easy, but there are many other contexts in quantum theory where these questions are very hard to answer. For example, let me give you two examples. In quantum field theory, you have some sort of non-perturbative definition, but it's not at the same level of rigor in general that you have here. You have, for example, Jan-Mills theory. You have some non-perturbative definition by using the lattice regularization, and then we know also that we have some sort of perturbative scheme, and it's a very important question if we can relate in some way the kind of non-perturbative definition that we have in quantum field theory, say via lattice regularization, to the kind of perturbative series that we can find in perturbation theory. Another even more interesting case is string theory, because in string theory we just don't even have this type of non-perturbative definition in general. So if you want to say something about perturbation, about the string theory beyond perturbation theory, one good way is to start looking very carefully at the perturbative series and see what the perturbative series can tell you about some sort of non-perturbative result. Okay? So in a sense, resurgence answers gives you three different general strategies. The first one is to make sense of this perturbative series. The second one is to relate the perturbative series to the non-perturbative result. In case you don't have a clear non-perturbative result, resurgence tells you, as we will see in a moment, that there is a further structure here, which is going to be the trans-series structure, and this actually allows you to have some hints of the non-perturbative structure of a theory, even if you don't have a non-perturbative definition. Okay? So in a sense, resurgence is the art of exploiting as much as possible the information contained in this perturbative theory. And another very important conceptual question for me in resurgence is what I'm going to call the semi-classical decoding. I mean, semi-classical decoding, as I will make clearer later, is the question of how much we can say about an exact result in quantum field theory by relying on some approximation scheme based on semi-classical intuition. It's not obvious at all that you can always make sense of results in quantum field theory using semi-classics. In a sense, resurgence will also try, it's also an approach which tries to make as much possible use of semi-classical intuition in order to get exact results in quantum theory in general. Okay. So these are some questions that I will address later on, but the first thing that resurgence tells us is that in general, if you want to obtain the exact result, for example here in this kind of problem, from a perturbative approach, you have to enlarge your perturbative approach. So the way to do this is to introduce what I will call trans-series. So this is the first thing that we will need. In this particular problem that I show you here, you don't really need trans-series, as we will see, but in general you will need trans-series. So this is the kind of first technical aspect of of resurgence theory that I want to introduce, and is this. Yes. Yes.
If you take theories where the, like the Edward Witten, which is one of the exact imperturbative theory, you cannot guess about the instanton problem. I mean, this is a case when perturbative expansion actually terminates.
Yes.
But you cannot, by knowing.
Yeah, I mean, in supersymmetric theories, you have sometimes this kind of. And this is like a special case in which the perturbation theory terminates.
So you cannot say anything about the instanton part because it's kind of better.
Yeah, but then perturbation theory is relatively easy in a sense because you know you have truncated it, so you have another. So you can define a transsitus in the context of cyber-Witten theory, and then the question is how you resound the all instanton perturbation. Right? But each series itself is finite. Yes.
You have the same problem in the harmonic oscillator, the standard eigenvalue. Terminates.
Absolutely, yeah.
You have in semi-classical approximation,
yes.
But you have other things in which there is a non-trivial.
Yeah. I mean, also in supersymmetric quantum mechanics, you have similar behaviors. You know, these are special cases in which perturbation theory terminates. But this, in a sense.
You mean that there is a method from the terminated perturbative series that I can guess?
Well, actually, when you have a sum over instanton sectors and the perturbation theory in each instanton sector is finite, then the problem is how to resolve the instanton series. But this is typically easier, as you know very well. This is actually is a different series. Yeah.
Let's go to introduction.
So actually, giving a general definition of transseries is not what I would like to do. So let me actually start giving you some flair of what is a transseries. In the case of ordinary differential equations. So transseries will give you, let's actually look at an ordinary differential equation and with an irregular singular point. So I'm going to give you some examples of this. So one example, which is also very useful, is Euler's equation. So I'm going to give you two examples, one which is very easy, and another which is more complicated. So this is just this equation. And we are going to, so the irregular singular point is at infinity. The other example, it's much more complicated, but can be treated with the same tool, which is the Pan-Level 2 equation. So these are differential equations. Or let me write it like this. Again, we are going to study this equation near the regular singular point kappa equals to infinity. So what can we say about these equations? Well, if you try to solve these differential equations in perturbation theory, you will find a solution again, a formal solution for the Euler equation, which is of this form. And actually, these coefficients, you can see, given by this expression. So this is exactly the same type of behavior we had before. We have a perturbative series, we have a formal power series in 1 over z, because we are studying the behavior near z equal to infinity, and the coefficients diverge factorially. Okay? And a is this constant appearing here, so a is a constant. And again, if you also look at this Pan-Level equation, you will find something similar, slightly more complicated. There is a formal solution, which actually grows like a square root of kappa. And then you can compute the subleading corrections to this. Again, this is an asymptotic expansion around kappa equal to infinity. So you have these two formal solutions, and these are the kind of expansions that you find when you study a differential equation in a regular singular point. Now, it turns out that it's very easy to see that you can actually write down a more general solution to these equations by writing, in the case of Euler equation, you can write an equation, more general solution, based on this asymptotic series, which I'm going to write like this. Okay, so this is actually, for any c, is a constant. This is a formal solution of the equation. And this is actually my first example of a transseries. So this is actually a sum of two formal power series, one which is an infinite power series, and this is again a truncated power series because you have no term. But this is a formal solution, and you can also write, in the case of Panleve 2, there is also a general trans series solution, which is U0 of kappa, and then you add, again with an arbitrary constant here, you can write down the series, which have this structure. And then, you know, you have here, this is so this is much more complicated, as you can see.
In kappa for z, no?
Sorry?
It's kappa, not z, in epsilon L.
Sorry, yeah, it's kappa, sorry, absolutely. And here, A is actually a constant as well, or thirds. So this, in this case, you can see that this is a formal solution by plugging this differential equation. And here, you can see that these UL functions satisfy linear differential equations. And they can be solved formally in power series. And actually, one very important aspect of this series is that it's also factorially divergent, and all the series appearing here, all these epsilon series, are also factorially divergent. But this gives you an infinite family of solutions, of formal solutions to these differential equations, and this type of solutions is what I call here transseries. So what characterizes transseries? Let me actually give you some characterization of transseries. What are the characteristics of transseries? Well, the first thing which is very important is that transseries involve typically more than one small parameter. When you write the standard asymptotic expansion solution to an ordinary differential equation of this type, you have typically one small parameter. Here it would be 1 over z, here would be 1 over kappa, and so on. But transseries have more than one small parameter. Because they have, say, the 1 over z or 1 over kappa of standard asymptotic solutions. But they also have, typically in these examples, small exponentials. You have here small exponentials with an essential singularity. Here you also have small exponentials. And these small exponentials typically involve are governed by some sort of constant, which depends on the equation you have. So here we have, and A is a constant, which is characteristic of the equation you're using. Okay. So that's the first important thing when you consider transseries. You have to enlarge your set of solutions to your differential equation by including not only the small parameter which is standard in this asymptotic expansion, but also a small parameter which is typical in this case exponential, exponentially small. And this is actually what in physics is interpreted as an instanton effect. So these are instanton corrections to your perturbative series. So this is what you can regard as the perturbative solution to the problem, in the sense that gives you a formal power series expansion in the original small parameter of the theory, but then you can enlarge this by adding these additional formal terms. Now, the second thing is that all series appearing here are factorially divergent in general. So here we have a special example in which the series gets truncated. But in the example of Panleve, it's very interesting because, first of all, we see that you need an infinite series of of this transcendence involve an infinite number of terms. And actually, each of these terms involves a series, an asymptotic, a series which is itself asymptotic. So all these numbers, U, L, N, for L fix, all grow like N factorial, okay, generically.
Are you restricting to Z being real here?
No, no, here everything is.
What do you mean by small exponential?
Well, the small exponential, it's what happens, when, of course, you know, when I mean small, means that if Z is real and positive and large, Z is large, then this is a small quantity, okay? But you can...
Are you restricting to Z being real?
No, I'm not restricting. This is just a way of talking. You know, when you talk about an exponential, you say that this is small because when you are expanding around infinity, this is a small quantity, if it's real. But you can think about this as just a formal power series or a formal trans series, and then, you know, you don't have to restrict this to be... There are actually more general trans series in which you don't have small exponentials but large exponentials.
Why do you want to think of it as being small?
Well, because in many problems, you want to actually construct a solution, say, on the real z-axis, near z going to plus infinity. You want to construct a real, an actual solution of the differential equations. And then these guys give you small corrections to this when you try to construct the solution in those regions. Okay.
My question was actually the other way around.
Yes.
When phi 0 truncates and the other one is infinite series.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. No, but this is very similar to Sever-Witten. This is, they have an instanton effect, you know, and then you have no perturbative series around it.
So
that's
a
one instanton effect.
Yes.
But in Sever-Witten there are infinite sum of instantons and the perturbative series.
The perturbative series truncates, and no, but you have many series, but each instanton series in Sever-Witten is also finite. So when I here call this small, it's of course assuming that Z is real and large, but as a formal construction, you can, you know, this doesn't depend on the values. When we construct real solutions, we will see what is the effect of this. And now a very important property is that all the different series, the different formal series appearing in the trans series, are related. And this is why the subject is called resurgence. I'm not going to discuss in detail the structural aspects of these relationships. Actually, Ricardo, I think, will discuss this a little bit more in detail. But one of the ways you can see that this is the case is that the large order behavior of these coefficients, so you see here the behavior of this coefficient an goes like a to the minus n, and a is the same quantity that appears here. And you can also see that if you look at these coefficients here, so you write this series y0 as un u0n kappa to the 3 n over 2, square root here, then these coefficients u0n, actually they are only non-zero when n is even, actually behave like 2n factorial and then a to the minus 2n when a is this quantity here. So you can see that the behavior, and this is only valid when n is very large. So the behavior of these coefficients when n is very large is controlled by the small exponential that appears in the other sectors of the trans series. And actually, this type of relations can be enlarged to a very precise description of the full asymptotic expansion of these coefficients when n is large in a 1 over n series. And the asymptotics of these coefficients involves the coefficients appearing in all these trans series here. So more precisely, so to make 3 more precise, late terms in the series, the perturbative series, are controlled by information in the tron series, in the other series of the tron series.
Marcus, we don't want to put any condition of picking the wave functions like L2 functions or something like that.
No, here we're in. No, this is.
It's not quantum mechanics. We are not asking the wave functions to be.
No, I mean, here in the first example I was giving, here, of course, here you have to work in. But you have to work in L2. But this is a Fermat power series. Here I don't have to worry about this. The question is how these two things are going to be related. There you have to be careful about how you define this. But here, you know, this is purely formal construction. You don't impose any L2R condition when you.
There is, but when we finally will construct E0 of G.
Absolutely. Yeah. We will see how this comes out. Of course, you know, you are absolutely right, and actually, essentially, this is going to fix the value of this coefficient.
Right.
Absolutely, yeah. But we will come to this later. What is very important in this subject is the formal construction of these tron series. You know, the fact you can construct these tron series in a purely formal way, it's very important because then you are going to use this as your building blocks in the solution. Okay, but it's important already that you are able to construct these tron series formally. You know, from the point of view of quantum theory, this is highly non-trivial because this actually means that you are doing perturbation theory, and then you are adding a new set of sectors to the theory, which in many cases can be interpreted as perturbations around instantons, around different saddle points that we will see here. But this is actually what gives the name resurgence. Resurgence means that the coefficients here are related to the coefficients to the information in the other terms of the tron series. So the information appearing here resurges in the other terms, and there are a sequence of relationships that you can describe in some detail. This is not the thing that I want to emphasize in my talk, but it's very important when you construct a tron series that these resurgent properties are there. And one way to make sure that you are constructing the right tron series is, for example, to study asymptotic properties of the coefficients here and make sure that they are related to the information appearing in the other tron series. This is very important. Otherwise, you are not really constructing the kind of tron series that appear in resurgent theory. Now, the fact that this is the case in the case of ODEs is a theorem, as I will make clear later. So, you can prove that this property in the case of ODEs. But in other examples in physics, we don't have the same technology as you have in studying ODEs, and then we have to work more experimentally. And the fact that asymptotics in one series is controlled by the other series in tron series is a very important tool to know that you are actually constructing the right object. Okay, so this is these are the main example. Yes,
I'm confused. What are the late terms in the expansion?
Late terms, I mean that, for example, here you look at this series. So this is the original asymptotic solution that you can have to this equation. What I mean is that when n is large, these coefficients have an asymptotic behavior which is controlled by quantities that appear in the other terms in the tron series. You see, if you construct this solution, for example, this constant a doesn't appear, but it appears as a fundamental constant controlling this small instant, this small exponential effect in the other terms of the tron series. In the same way that here, you know, this small term knows about the behavior of these coefficients when n is large. So this is a general property of tron series, that these series and the rest of the series in these tron series are not completely independent, but are related by some sort of relationship that you can make precise. But one of the most important consequences of this relationship is precisely the fact that the late-term behavior of the coefficients appearing in the original series is controlled by the information contained in this tron series. You see, if you just write this coefficient here, which is if you just write this series here, which is what you would do in a standard solution of this differential equation in an irregular singular point, you wouldn't know what is this A related to. You would maybe find it experimentally, but you wouldn't know what it is. But if you construct the tron series, you will see that this A is fixed by the construction of the tron series, and this A is telling you exactly how your first series behaves when n is large. So this is the kind of, and this is what is this is where the name resurgence comes from. Resurgence comes from the relationship between different terms in the transitive. And this is not the kind of solution that you would construct by using elementary means.
In order to have complete analogy with the oscillator case, yes, the perturbed oscillator case, you have to have on E0 of G differential equation, basically. Because you have all the E's here, you're talking about properties of
right.
solution, when there was in the other equation,
yeah.
it was properties of energy.
Yeah, I mean, when you construct transitive, the best case scenario is when you have some sort of recursion that you can solve by enlarging your answers for the recursion. That's technically the case. Okay, but I will now come back to the quantum mechanics example, and you will see how. Now let me give you other examples of transitive. So this is other examples of transitive, which appear very often. The first example is saddle point approximations to integrals. So remember that you have an integral defined, typical integral that appears in saddle point approximations. So where Z is an appropriate contour in the complex plane. So you know that if you want to calculate this integral in the saddle point approximation, you have to look at the critical points of F. So this will give you typically a finite set of saddle points. S, these are saddle points. And now, depending on the value of h bar, you will find the steepest descent contours associated to this saddle point. Let me call them Zn, which depends on the value of h bar. Actually, it depends on the argument of h bar there. And when you do this kind of analysis, what you do is actually to decompose your integral. Let me call it AN. Well, this is a. Okay, let me call it like this set. So this is just to emphasize the similarity. And then you will have here formal power series that I'm going to call like this, which comes from the expansion, saddle point expansion of the integral around this saddle point. And then you write the integral, original integral, as a linear combination. So these are coefficients, as a linear combination of these saddle point expansions. And this is actually also an example of transitive. Huh? This is another example of transitive in which the formal power series, which are typically divergent, appear as the saddle point expansions of these integrals around the saddle points. And then you have a number of coefficients here. And of course, these coefficients are not arbitrary. You can fix them by comparing with the original definition of the integral. But the structure that you find is very much the same, and actually there are simple examples like the AD function, for example, where you can analyze the problem in both ways. So for example, the AD function, you can think about it as solving a differential equation, or by using the contour integral representation of this AD function, and then you will see that you get two power series, one which goes like 2/3 to the 3 to the 3 halves, and another which goes with e to the plus 2/3 of the 2 to the 3 halves. So you get two formal power series expansions with different asymptotic behavior, and this can be regarded as transitive for this differential equation, or they can be regarded as two different saddle point expansions in the integral representation of the AD functions. So you see again that here, already in the example of the AD function, the transitives have different exponential behavior, okay? Like here. Here you have a series which goes like a square root of k, and this goes like square root of k times an exponential. So the different terms in the transitions have different exponential behavior, and this is exactly what you have in the elementary example of the AD function. You can think about the two formal power series solution to this AD equation as two different transitions having different exponential behavior again. Okay. So this is a kind of very an example where transitions are actually relatively simple. You have a typically finite number of terms in standard integrals. And then we can now think about what happens in quantum mechanics again. So because once you understand that transitions appear when you treat standard saddle point expansions in standard integrals, you can boldly go to path integrals. And then you can see that in quantum mechanics, you will also have this type of transitions. So let me give you an example which is slightly different from this one. And this is that it's much easier to see how to construct the transitions. And this is an example which is well known, which is the double well oscillator. So you have something similar. Again, g bigger than zero. And this is the standard potential with two degenerate minima. So this is minus 1 over 2 square root of g, and this is plus 1 over 2 square root of g. These are the two critical, this is the two minima of this potential. And in quantum mechanics, you can now again ask, you know that this potential has the same, has similar properties from the point of view of the Schrödinger equation that the previous one. So in particular, there is a ground state energy here, and then you could ask what is the kind of information that you get from perturbative series. So there is a perturbative series that you can calculate very easily by doing small oscillations around this minima. This is something again that you can calculate very easily in quantum mechanics. So you get something like this. But we know that if you want to actually complete the information, if you want to actually consider what is, you want to reconstruct the actual ground state energy from the information that you take in perturbation theory, this is not going to be enough. And you actually need precisely to go to this transitions framework. And what you find here is that there is a more complicated function, a more complicated transitions, which involves the perturbative transitions, the perturbative series that you compute in standard quantum mechanics, and then you will have other corrections. And here, f1 of g again involves non-perturbative, involves this small exponential effect. So this is of the form 2g to the 1/2. Let me just write the first order, whatever, 6g over the square root of 2 pi. And then this multiplies an asymptotic series in g. And we see again here the presence of an exponentially small effect. And this is one important case, as in contrast to the previous case of the oscillator with a positive quartic potential. Here, in order to reconstruct this function, as I will make clear in a moment, you only need this perturbative series. But here, with this perturbative series, you are not able to reconstruct this ground state energy. You really definitely need this further transitions here. And physically, it's very nice. This has a very nice interpretation when you consider the path integral approach. to this problem. So one way of doing this is to consider the thermal partition function of the problem, which is the trace of e to the minus beta h. This has information about the spectrum of the theory, because it contains information about the ground state energy when beta is large. And if you consider the path integral calculation of this quantity, you have to actually consider the Euclidean action and to consider periodic trajectories, a path integral over periodic trajectories. So q0 is equal to q beta. So beta here becomes some sort of Euclidean time. And actually, this perturbative series comes from constant periodic solutions, so solutions which are localized here and here. And when you do the perturbative expansion of the path integral in the same way or in a generalized way as you would do a saddle point expansion in standard integrals, you will actually generate these series here. So where does these new series come from? Well, in order to find it, you can actually look at what is called the twisted partition function, which calculates the same type of quantities but including the parity. And this actually, it's a path integral of the same type, but in which now you impose periodic boundary conditions in which the nth point of the trajectory is minus the nth point, the original point of the trajectory. And you can see that here constant trajectories do not contribute anymore, but there is a trajectory that contributes, which is the one that interpolates between this point and this other point. So this path integral, the leading order contribution, comes from a non-trivial saddle point. Yeah, this is the tunneling effect. or instanton, so this is the tunneling effect. But precisely the tunneling effect, if you want to relate it to this, the tunneling effect is actually physically the physical mechanism which is responsible for the appearance of this tunnel series. This tunnel series is precisely due to the tunneling effect, and this exponentially small quantity that appears here is precisely due to, is actually the value of the classical Euclidean action on this classical solution. So that's how
C is fixed.
Yeah, absolutely. C is with some subtlety that I'm going to come back in a moment. Okay. So
what is the after the summation? Then you skip C phi 1 g plus dot dot dot.
Yeah. Here the problem is that there will be also multi-instanton contributions, because you see you can go here, but you can also go and come back. You can go and come back and come back again. So there are multi-instanton sectors that will give you precisely higher order trans-series terms in this formal series.
Because there are two zeros, and there will be tunneling effect between these two zeros.
Yes.
So how come this?
Well, you know, you can have, for example, you know, these kind of solutions are solutions which go like this. So, but then you can have a solution which goes like this, stays a little moment there, and then comes back, right? And then you can repeat this structure many times, and this will give you actually higher order terms here, which give you more and more exponentially more smaller and smaller terms. Remember that here, for example, in this series here, you know, these exponentials actually get larger and larger by an integer factor. So the first trans-series correction has exponential with L equal to 1, then there is L equal 2, L equal 3, and so on. So you see that this in these quantum mechanical examples, this the higher order trans-series here will correspond precisely to these instantons, to this multi-instanton set.
And the coefficients would be different, and C's would be different.
Actually C is going to be the same always. It's like here, it will be half C squared, C cubed, and so on. You know, here you will see that you don't need to have differences. I mean, once you have one ambiguity, and then the rest of the transistors will inherit this ambiguity. Okay, like here. Okay, you have one ambiguity, but you see that at higher orders, you just have C squared, C cube, and so on. So this is one example. Actually, so I wanted to give you some elementary example, some example in quantum mechanics, and now I want to give you an example in quantum field theory. So this is much harder. Did I put the eraser? Oh, here, sorry. Thank you. So let me give you an example in quantum field theory. So of course, in quantum field theory, again, you can think about, so this is an example in quantum mechanics. So you consider, say, in quantum field theory, you will have the path integral for in the path integral formulation. You can, for example, consider the analog of this quantity, the partition function of the theory at a finite volume. Then this is going to be a path integral of this type with, say, a Euclidean, with an Euclidean action. Where here I'm being very schematic, where phi are the fields of the theory. And this is just. And then, you know, there will be always typically a trivial configuration. Say phi equals zero, so we will see an example of this. And then there will be non-trivial saddles. And the perturbative expansion of this path integral and this trivial configuration gives me the perturbative series, the standard perturbative series. That is actually how you generate perturbative series in quantum field theory. But if you do the perturbative expansion around a non-trivial saddle, as it happens in this, as it happened in this example, you will get actually the trans-series structure of quantum field theory. So it's nothing very special. It's just a trans-series in quantum field theory. It's just it's a perturbative expansion and a non-trivial saddle point solution to the theory. So, for example, in Jan-Mills theory at finite volume, you can consider instanton solutions of Jan-Mills theory, and then the perturbative expansion in the background of such an instanton field will give you a generalized series, which will be the starting point for building a trans-series solution, in the same way that in quantum mechanics, looking around things and those gives you a trans-series. Now, this program in quantum field theory is very hard, but there is a very nice example, which is Chern-Simons theory, where this can be made very concrete. So Chern-Simons theory, as a quantum field theory, was introduced by Witten. So here, the action here, so this is a theory for, a G connection on a three-manifold A on a three-manifold M. So the action of the theory can be taken as k over 4 pi, and then you have the trace of A, what's dA, plus 2/3 of AQ. So this is the Chern-Simons action. And then on a three-manifold M, you can consider a function of k, which is given by the formal partition function obtained by doing this. So have something like this. So here you need an I in order for this. So here actually there is no much distinction between Euclidean and Minkowski theory. So you have an I here in order for this exponential to be gauge independent. So this is how you define the path integral of Chern-Simons theory. And actually we know that this, well, we it's conjecture that this is equal to the Witten-Rosketti-Hiltura F invariant of M, which can be defined by purely combinatorial ways. Okay? So in a sense, this is an example in which this Witten-Rosketti-Hiltura F invariant of M plays the role of E0 in the case of the quantum mechanical problem. So if you want, this is the non-perturbative, this is the exact or non-perturbative answer. And actually, the Witten argued in 1989 that this invariant of three manifolds M can be obtained by doing this as the partition function of this quantum field theory. So this is an excellent laboratory in which you can try to compare this exact answer with the sort of perturbative expansions that we get in quantum field theory. And actually, there are many interesting results along these lines. And you can actually construct very explicitly trans-series starting from this exact non-perturbative answer. So let me give you an example, which I think is very nice. So let's suppose that M is a Seyfert manifold characterized by, say, some integers PR. So I'm not going to get into the definition of this mathematical object. Just suffices to say that this is a three-manifold M, which is defined by a series of coprime integers R from 1 to S. You can actually construct this manifold by doing surgery on a certain knot with certain surgery coefficients which are related to PR, and then you get some manifold M which is defined by these coprime integers. And actually, Lorenz and Rosansky computed this invariant WRTM for this cipher manifold, and they saw that it's a finite sum of terms, and the first term that you find here can be written as an integral of certain function fy. It's just very simple. It's a Gaussian integral y squared over 4 g dy, where g is actually 2 pi I over k times p, where p is the product of these prs. And then there are other terms here, but this integral here, let me write what is this function, because actually this is a result which we have with Sergey, which is a very nice example of this construction. So Fy can be described very explicitly. 2 sine of y over 2 minus s, and then product of k equal 1 to s of 2 sine y over 2 pr. So this is this function. And you see that, in a sense, this reduces the problem of calculating this contribution to the Witten-Resetti-Hilbert invariant to precisely the kind of saddle point calculation that you do here. Actually, here c is just e to the pi I over 4 times r. So it's this diagonal contour in the complex plane. And you can see that this tells you that this invariant can be written as a perturbative series, okay, plus other terms here. I'm not writing these other terms, I could write them, but the importance of this term is that, which is what I wrote here, so this I'm going to call Z perturbative of K. The importance of this term is that this was identified as the contribution by Lorenz and Rosansky, as the contribution of the trivial connection A equals 0 to the path integral. So you see, just to recap a little bit, in the case of transaxial theory, we have a very special situation in which this can give us this actually invariant gives you the sad non-perturbative answer, and then we can compare to what we would obtain from a path integral treatment of this theory, and you can see that this gives you a power series that can be obtained from the perturbative expansion of this saddle point integral around the trivial saddle point y equals zero. So here we have a series which corresponds to what we the analog of phi zero in these constructions that I showed you before, and then there will be other contributions which will be the analog of
number k enters
k enters here and here. Okay, is the level.
But it enters in the definition of the restricting toilet?
Absolutely, absolutely. You need a level here. This also depends on k, absolutely. Yeah. So this is a case in which you can actually ask yourself if you can decompose this exact non-perturbative answer in terms of a trans-series expression. And it's one of the few examples in quantum theory where you could do that. Okay, so this is kind of a quick tour of trans-series. And the other ingredient that we need in order to make sense of the theory of resurgence is actually how to make, we have to make sense of this trans-series. So far I was writing this trans-series as formal expansion. So actually here.
I have a question.
Yes.
So cipher pinfolder constructed yes. using filling up the knots.
Yes.
So point is, do you have any idea how to construct means over the 3 manifold you have vibrations? It's a natural question. If you so this theory actually works there?
Over I mean, you can define this invariant for any 3 manifold, right? Now, the why I'm choosing here cipher manifolds is because these cipher manifolds can be constructed using very simple ingredients in the Witten-resurgence feature F construction. If you think about the conformal field theory associated to this Chern-Simons theory, here you only need, in order to calculate this invariant, you only need the S and T matrices of the Westumino-Witten.
Oh,
yeah, G is sorry, here G is SU2, absolutely. For this result, G is SU2. This is for SU2, okay? So this is for G SU2, absolutely. So what makes these cipher manifolds particular is that you can construct this invariant using the simplest ingredients in this theory, okay, which are the S and T matrices. For other 3 manifolds, you will need more information coming from the 6 quantum 6J symbols and so on, but cipher manifolds only need the simplest ingredients. Okay, that's why they are particularly nice to study, because you can make everything very explicit. But this is just a technical issue. Now, of course, you know, you could. The question is if you can do this decomposition in other cases. Now, so here in this case we have this equality, but the question is because here the perturbative series appears as just the expansion of this saddle point integral, but the general question remains, if I give you a theory and you construct the trans-series, how you are going to recover the original answer using the information in this trans-series? And the answer of the theory of resonance is that you should use some sort of Borel resummation procedure. Okay, so this is the next technical ingredient that I'm going to introduce. Yes.
This is a PQFT example, not QFT example.
Yes. Yeah, but I'm going to give some historical remarks why this is an example that we can actually, because in a sense the program of resurgence has been going on under other names in physics, and the main question of resurgence for me is the question of can you actually write exact quantities in quantum field theory using just semi-classical analysis. And we know that, for example, for Jan-Mills theory in infinite volume, the most likely answer is no, you cannot. And this was like a main drawback for the program of semi-classical decoding in the 70s. You couldn't make sense of instanton calculus in Jan-Mills theory because of the infrared divergence of instanton calculus in a standard Jan-Mills theory in infinite volume. And this is a case where essentially the full program of resurgence cannot be pushed. So in a sense, what we are doing here is looking at examples where it can be pushed. But in a sense, the whole program of resurgence came to a stop in the 70s because this problem of Jan-Mills. So this is the reason why I'm looking at TQFT. If you do supersymmetric QFT, you are also in business because you can tame instantons.
I actually, that's what I wanted to say. This I would call TQFT, and the supersymmetric one I would call QFT.
Okay. Yeah, but still, QFTs, supersymmetric QFTs from the point of view of resurgence are also very tame, right? Because instantons can be made in n equal to superjammers, you can do instanton calculus.
Exactly.
That's a whole point.
Well,
instantons, anti-instantons, it becomes trouble. When you only instantons, in n equal to zero, there are only.
In ordinary Jan-Mills theory, just the instanton expansion doesn't make sense, just in general, right? Yeah, because you don't have infrared cutoffs, essentially, while in supersymmetric Jan-Mills you have. So that's the main problem.
Since this point emerges, but I just ask you to know that previously when you were considering the quantum mechanical point of view, so there you calculated the cut-ending contributions.
Yes.
So you could have also considered the supersymmetric quantum mechanics.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Trace of that thing that we calculated.
Yes.
So that would give the same results or something?
Well, actually, again, supersymmetric quantum mechanics, there are is non-generic situations. So, for example, you can have situations in which the ground state energy is zero in perturbation theory, and the first contribution is purely non-perturbative. So these are kind of non-generic cases in which these transients are essentially truncated in kind of peculiar ways. But this is essentially the non-generic case. Okay? And people have actually looked at, at these cases from the point of view of resurgence. But here I want to focus in the generic case in which you have infinite series appearing everywhere. Okay. So the technical ingredient that makes sense of so far my transseries are purely formal. So are objects that I can compute order by order in my coupling constant in my small parameter and order by order in my exponentially small parameter. So how do you make sense of these formal series which are divergent, have zero radius of convergence? Now, the trick is very old, it's called Borel resummation. So let me just remind you the definition. So you have a formal series, ANZN, where AN diverges factorially, so has this sort of behavior. So let me assume that the coefficients grow like this. Then the Borel transform of this series is defined by a very kind of a stupid way of making the series convergent, which is just removing the factorial that makes the series divergent. So you remove the factorial, and then you get a series like this, which has a finite radius of convergence, just by construction, right? Because this is the radius of convergence will be actually A here, okay? Now, once you do this, you go from a divergent formal power series to a power series defining a function in a neighborhood of the origin. So typically, this defines a function in the neighborhood of the origin. And typically, you can extend analytically this function to a larger domain. So you can.
Is it weighted zeta function regularization?
No, this is not zeta function regularization. This is just
weighted. I'm just attaching the weight with the weighted zeta function.
But zeta functions has nothing to do with zeta letters.
Yeah. No, this is just the inverse of the Laplace transform, as you will see in a moment. Okay. So you can now if I give you a transseries psi of z, which I'm going to write like f0 of z plus sum of n equal 1 cn l cl phi lz. You can, of course, apply this Borel transform here. But remember that these transseries are up to an exponentially small term that multiplies them are also power series. So you can also do here the Borel transform. Maybe sometimes with some small modifications because sometimes there are overall factors in front and so on. But you know this can be actually modified appropriately. So from a transseries you can also do a formal Borel transform and then you will get some sort of Borel transform transseries. And now all the ingredients appearing here are functions which have a finite radius of convergence, and typically they can be analytically extended to a larger domain. So that's the kind of the first ingredient. Now, this is not the Borel sum, the Borel resummation of the series. The Borel resummation of the series needs a further ingredient, which is precisely the Laplace transform of this Borel transform. So, but going to this Borel resummation, let me give you a nice example of Borel resummation, of one of the examples that I considered before. So remember that here I define this perturbative series here, so appearing in terms of Simon's theory. So this is maybe something that Sergei will discuss more carefully. So this was defined as the asymptotic expansion of this integral fy e to the minus y squared over 4g dy. And you can see that this is a series which up to a trivial constant is given by n fn gamma n plus 1 half, and then 4g to the n plus 1 half. So you see fn here is the power series expansion of this function that was involved in this thing. And you see this function is holomorphic at the origin, so this gives you a convergent power series. But you see that the divergence of the asymptotic divergence, the factorial divergence of the perturbative expansion in this case, is due to this gamma factorial thing. So what you can do now is to do a Borel resummation of this perturbative thing, in which I do a slightly, so let me call this an k over n minus 1 half. Remember that g was proportional to 1 over k, so let me write it like this. So this is a trick that we did in our paper with Sergei and Pavel. So what is important is to remove the factorial. So let me call this z psi. So here this is a slightly modified version of the Borel transformation, in which I remove the factorial by dividing by gamma n plus 1 half, not by just n factorial. And you can see that in this case, this function is very easy. You just recover the original function f that appeared here. So this here z is 2 pi I xi over p. So this is kind of trivial exercise in which you have an asymptotic series defined by a Gaussian integration of a holomorphic function at the origin, and then the Borel transform essentially gives you back this holomorphic function. So this is a very simple example. Now, one of the consequences of resurgence, remember that resurgence told me that the large order behavior of the coefficients appearing here was related to the information contained in this general transseries. One of the nice consequences of that is that this Borel transform will have a singularity structure. Now, the singularity structure of this Borel transform will be related to the information contained in the transseries. So a statement about large order behavior of this divergent series will become a statement about the singularity structure of this Borel transform. And you can see, if you remember the definition of this fy, which has these hyperbolic signs, the singularities of this function fy are precisely telling you information about the other non-trivial connections of this Chern-Simons invariant, of this Witten-Regenstein-Turek invariant. So when you do the Borel transform of this divergent series, you will get this holomorphic function, which will have a set of singularities, and the singularities of the Weber transform of this are telling you information about the other connections, non-trivial connections of this invariant. And this is again the power of resurgence. Resurgence is telling you that even if you do your expansion on a particular saddle point, this expansion will know about these other saddle points. And in this case, in the case of Chern-Simons theory, it's actually very beautiful because essentially by construction we know that this function knows about the other non-trivial connections. So you could just do perturbation theory around the trivial connection and you will discover the whole structure of non-trivial flat connections on this manifold just by looking at this perturbative series. So this is another consequence of resurgence. Okay, how I'm doing in time? Maybe do you want to do a small break? Okay, let me then continue. So the Borel transform, so this is this procedure is called the Borel transform. So it starts with an divergent series, it gives you a series with a finite radius of convergence, which you might be able to extend analytically to a larger domain. And now the question is how to recover something related to the original series from the Borel transform. And this gives us suggests doing this procedure of resummation. So this is the Borel resummation. This is what I'm going to define. I'm going to denote the S of phi of z. And this is defined by this Laplace transform. So you do this Laplace transform. So if this integral exists, the original series is called Borel resummable, and the integral is called the Borel resummation. So you see, in order for this integral to exist, you have to be able essentially to extend the Borel transform to a neighborhood of the positive real axis, and you need some decay properties of this transform on the positive real axis. When this integral exists, it's called the Borel resummation. And why is this so? Because why is this object interesting? Because if this quantity exists, then you can see that it has an asymptotic expansion, which is actually the original series 5z. It's very easy to check this in the definition. So this, when it exists, is a function. It's a function of z. It's, you know, this integral will exist in a range of values of z. And when it exists, it gives you an exact, a true function whose asymptotic expansion is phi of z. So this is the basic idea of Borel resummation. It's a very simple procedure. But it's important to extend it to a more slightly general case, because it's very often the case that this function has actually singularities on the positive real axis. Okay? So very often you have very obvious obstructions to extend this, because you might have singularities on the positive real axis, say poles or branch cuts. And in this case, you can, this integral will not exist in itself, but then you can deform the contour and define, instead of doing the integral on the positive real axis, you consider two different integrals in contours slightly above or below the positive real axis. And this gives me the lateral Borel resummation of this series. So here there are two of them. Okay, now the question now is the following. Once we do this, we can take a transseries and consider this Borel transform. And in principle, you can also consider the resolution.
Each of these have same asymptotics, right?
Yes, they also have the same asymptotics, yeah. They differ on, I mean, both of them have the asymptotics to phi z, absolutely. And they differ. Absolutely. We will make this explicit in a second. Okay. So now the question we can ask is the following. So let's suppose we have a transseries angle to the node like psi of z, z, which is of this form that I was telling you before. So this is not the, let me point out that this is not the most general transseries you can consider. One can consider much more general transseries. This is, for example, the one that was appropriate for part level 2. But in general, you might have many different constants, many different exponential terms, and so on. But let me just focus on this, which is already sufficiently complicated. So I have these transseries. So what I can do now is to do...
Where is the exponential term?
Here is here. The, all these are exponential terms. I'm not indicating them, but all these objects, I'm going to have this sort of... include this sort of exponential behavior.
When you wrote Borel transform under that, you were not very clear about
I absolutely. I was telling here that in order to do the Borel transform, I was saying this verbally, okay? But what happens that here you will have an exponential, and typically you also will have to have some maybe some fractional powers here, okay? But then what you do is essentially you remove the exponential, and then you do some sort of variant of the Borel transform that applies to all these things. But you know, this is not crucial. So let me now define some sort of lateral Borel resummation. So assuming that we are in a situation which we have to do a lateral Borel resummation of the whole thing, so this will be just S plus minus of F0 Z. And then I can consider this thing, again with the proviso that I have to remove this exponential terms when I do the Borel transform. Okay, so this object is slightly different already because at least you have still an infinite power, this is still a formal object, but now its ingredients are actually true functions if this lateral Borel resummation converges. Even assuming that there are some singularities on the positive real axis, this object after doing the control definition might define a true function. So you have this sort of situation. And now the question, and this actually defines, the question is if this defines a true function, okay? And now what I'm going to state, this is the Borel resummation of the transseries, lateral Borel resummation of the transseries. Sorry?
You say a true function.
Now, what I mean is that each of the components is a true function. Now, it's not obvious that the whole thing will converge, right? Absolutely. This is not at all. But at least we have improved the situation in the sense that each of these transseries is now maybe a function if these Borel transforms are well defined. So this is the Borel transform. And now let me state a principle. Which is for me the actual true conceptual core of resurgence. And I think that's that's what guides the whole subject in a sense. And this is the principle, so what I call semi-classical, I referred to this before, semi-classical decoding. Okay? So what is this? Now I can, sorry? I see. Comes like this? Like this?
No, lifted.
Oh, lifted. The middle blackboard a little bit. Okay.
Like this?
Okay. No shadow. Okay. So the principle of. Like this? So semi classical decoding. What I mean by this? Okay. So let me try to state this mathematical. Let's suppose that you have a function, a true function, well defined function, with the asymptotic expansion given by a formal power series. Okay? So FZ has an asymptotic series F0Z. This is actually what happens in, this is in a sense the common situation to everything that we have seen here.
For Z equals 0 or Z equals infinity?
Well, let's say z equals 0, okay? Around z equals 0, okay? So this is the common situation to everything I have discussed here. In quantum mechanics, you have perturbation theory. In ordinary differential equations with regular singular points, you have the formal power series around the regular singular point. In quantum field theory, z is the coupling constant, and so on. And this is typically what you have. You have a perturbative series, and then you might have a non-perturbative answer that you try to reconstruct. So we say that fz admits a semi-classical decoding. If phi 0 of z can be promoted to a transseries, so that's the first if, you have to be to a transseries. Psi of z, which is model summable, which is lateral model summable. Means that this whole object exists, so at least for some range of values of z, this whole object exists, this whole sum, infinite sum, converges, and such that you can actually reconstruct fz by this procedure. So this is equal to s plus minus of xi of z, with for some value of z. And actually, there are typically two values of z. When this actually happens, typically both lateral resummation exist, but with different values of z. And actually, z plus minus z minus is actually the Stokes constant of the problem. So this is a kind of generic situation. Now, so this is not something that you find in the articles of resurgence, you know, this idea of semi-classical decoding, but I think it's the core of the problem. So the idea is that you have to be able, the idea is that you have a quantity in quantum theory that you want to reconstruct, you typically only have the perturbative series. Semi-classical decoding means that you are able to reconstruct this whole thing by using the perturbative series plus a transseries and then do inverted resummation. And this transseries means typically you have to enlarge the kind of sectors that you consider. So for example, in quantum physics, you have to consider other sectors, like instanton sectors. And then you must be able to reconstruct exactly this object from this Borel resummation. And this at least for some values of z. Now, this is very important because it's not at all obvious that a quantity that you have defined by whatever procedure can be decoded in this way. And in quantum field theory, we have a very good example where this doesn't seem to be the case, which is pure Jahn-Mills. Pure Jahn-Mills theory, in infinite volume, you have a renormalized perturbative series, but nobody knows how to do this. Nobody knows how to reconstruct observables in pure Jahn-Mills theory, just doing some sort of semi-classical decoding in terms of transseries. You can do it at finite volume. There is a well-defined instanton procedure to doing this in finite volume. But nobody knows how to do this in infinite volume. So this is by far not obvious. Now, what has been happening in the last years and why there has been this resurgence of resurgence is because people have decided that Jahn-Mills theory is too hard, and we have looked at other examples where the life seems to be simpler, and these examples involve models of string theory. We have revisited many cases in quantum mechanics, and there has been a lot of work of people trying to look at quantum field theory in finite volume, but with different boundary conditions, which are closer to the infinite volume limit. And this is work by Gerald Dune and Mitat Unsal and collaborators, which have revisited many quantum field theory, standard quantum field theory problems, still at finite volume, because nobody knows how to do this in infinite volume, but changing boundary conditions and finding interesting transseries structure, and in particular, they have been able to identify semi-classical models for renormal non-divergences, which is one of the main problems in Jahn-Mills theory. So this principle of semi-classical decoding, it's very interesting, and let me make a theorem. This is a theorem, I'm not going to state it, but this is a theorem. Semi-classical decoding is true for all the E's with irregular singular points. So this is a theorem which I guess goes back to Ecalle with important contributions by Ovidiu Costin and probably others. So this principle is semi-classical decoding, and this is highly non-trivial because, for example, imagine that you look again at Panleve 2. I mean, it's not obvious at all that from the transitions I wrote, you can actually reconstruct the whole solution to Panleve 2. So, you know, one thing that you can do is, for example, to consider what is called the Hastings-MacLeod solution to Panleve 2, which is a very interesting solution, which has this asymptotic, this chi, when chi is bigger than 1, much larger than 1, this actually goes like a square root of k, and then it decays exponentially at minus infinity with a sort of AD behavior. This function is very important because this is kind of the building block of many problems involving Panleve 2, like the Tracy Whedon law and so on. So this decays at minus infinity with some kind of 80 sort of law. So this is when k goes to minus infinity. So this is Hastings-MacLeod solution. And actually, you can, as an application of this semi-classical decoding, you can write this function as a Borel transform. So it's s plus minus of, let me write just the plus solution, of xi, but actually says minus, of kc. And c is a value here, which is actually the Stone constant divided by 2. So you can actually, psi here is the transitive solution that I was writing before for Panleve 2. And c has a fixed value. Actually, I think you can use s2, something like that. Okay. So you have actually two different, you can reconstruct this in two different ways. If you use one lateral Borel resummation, you will have to use c plus plus s over 2, and you use the lateral Borel resummation with minus, you will have said minus, minus s2, and they differ in the Stoke constant. And this Stoke constant has been computed by people, so you can actually completely reconstruct this solution from this semi-classical decoding. And this is what semi-classical decoding is. Semi-classical decoding is telling you that this Hastings-MacLeod solution can be thought as an asymptotic series plus a series of instanton corrections, and the structure of instanton corrections is completely encoded in this transseries.
The way you wrote the Stokes content, it's a little symbolic. You were saying C minus is the Stokes content. So that's just the contours, but I guess what you mean is you're looking at some fundamental system and there is Stokes matrices and so on.
Yeah, absolutely.
My question is, the way you described it, there just seems to be one Stokes ray, the real line, but...
In general, absolutely, absolutely. Absolutely, you know, here I'm assuming that, you know, this series is divergent around this ray, and then there will be other Stoke constants along other rays. Yeah, absolutely. In this case,
one irregular singularity, or there could be many.
I mean, here I'm considering one single irregular singularity, and then you have the Stokes. Here I'm considering implicitly assuming that the Stokes line is around the positive real radius. Okay, because I'm doing the lateral Borel resummation in that direction, but you could do lateral Borel resummations at different angles. I mean, this is just an extension of the theory I have presented you here, and then you could consider this phenomenon along other rays in the complex plane.
Elevate two, for instance, I don't know, what is it, six Stokes sectors or something?
Yeah. This is in order to reconstruct these Hastings-MacLeod solutions around the real axis, you know, you are actually, you know, here you are considering the ray which goes along the positive real axis. This is what I need in this case, and this is the Stoke constant appropriate for that axis. Okay, for that direction. So this is, of course, a very particular example. But what I want to emphasize, so here this is the Stoke constant associated to that line, okay? Yes?
But if you speak of decoding, it means that you have a way to tell us what the C plus and C minus are.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I don't think you have it always, or?
Well, you might not have an explicit way of finding it, and this is one of the main difficulties of the. But already the fact that this can be decoded in this way with just a choice of C I think this is highly non-trivial, right?
Okay, but still, if you can't determine C, then it's...
There is a unique value of C which is fixed by, if you know FZ, of course. But at least this tells you something. Okay, imagine that you don't know how to define C. At least you know that this quantity defines you a one-parameter family in this case, because again, in a simple setting, a one-parameter family of functions built upon your perturbative series. Okay, and I think this is already very important. For example, sorry,
is that an independent principle which determines C, independent from the fact that it has to give the final answer? Correct?
No. That's a very important thing, and here I differ from other people who think that already this is already, you know, resurgence doesn't fix the value of Z. So resurgence, if you want to, sometimes people say that resurgence defines non-perturbatively the problem, and this is not completely true. Resurgence defines a non-perturbative object up to a multi-parameter ambiguity, which is in this case, in this simple case, is just encoded in this constant C. But you see, any choice of C will give you a well-defined function with that asymptotic, with that classical asymptotic. So resurgence by itself doesn't tell you what is the right object here. On the contrary, if you know the right object here, resurgence might help you in finding this constant here. So the principle of semi-classical decoding tells you that if you know this quantity, then you might be able to decode it in this way, and it's not going to give you the precise value of C. You will have to find it by fitting. And this is one of the main technical problems you find in semi-classical decoding. That even if you have...
In QFT, we would know what C is because it's instant on counting parameters. In every QFT, we know what it's exponential.
Actually, you cannot know C if there are singularities in the Borel plane, because the value of C depends on the choice of lateral resummation. This is something that Parisi, for example, I think understood very clearly already for a standard Jamil's theory. You know, this quantity is ambiguous unless you tell me what is your prescription for Borel resummation. And this is actually the meaning of a Stokes phenomenon in the context of resurgence. It means that there is no a single value of C.
But are you always assuming that there's some differential, some ODE with...
No, no, it's ODE. No, this has not to be there has not to be an ODE. I mean, the main problem in resurgence is first to construct the transseries, formal transseries. So if you have a setting similar to an ODE or a difference equation, a recursive equation, you typically can construct the transseries. But even the formal construction of transseries in many cases is very hard. In standard quantum field theory, doing perturbation theorem on an instanton is technically very, very hard. Already computing higher order terms in quantum field theory is very hard. Imagine around a non-trivial instanton background is even harder. So even the formal construction of transseries very often is not very simple. Okay. Now, once you have solved the problem of constructing the transseries formally, you have to go a step further and do the Borel resummation. And there you have the same kind of problems here. And finally, if you know this answer, you might be able to try to find what are the values of Z which actually fit this non-perturbative value. And this is what I call semi-classical decoding.
Maybe this lateral Borel condition is a little bit restrictive, because in this case, when we know C for the quantum field theorems, which is instant on counting parameters, it might be that it's not a lateral Borel transform which gives you F, but something else.
Maybe just some contours.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there might be. Yeah. Again, you know, here I'm restricted to a very kind of simple example of resurgence. I mean, I could have much more complicated set of Cs. We could have, depending on the structure of singularity, you can have contours enturing these singularities in different ways and so on. But, this is if you want a simple example of the semi-classical decoding in this, which, for example, for Panleve 2 is sufficient. But, of course, you know, in general, you might have to enlarge very much this. But the idea is that you always have to be able to relate an exact quantity to a Borel resum transseries. That's, I think, the main moral issue. If you have to do something different, then, you know, you are leaving the realm of resurgence. Yes?
So this ambiguity of choice of C that we're talking about, can I say it differently, that this is basically choice of the contour, say in a path integral, original path integral, where we do settle point approximation?
Yeah.
It's a question of which contour we choose.
Yeah. I mean, if you have a path integral, so for example, let's say even standard integrals. If you choose the contour if you have a well-defined contour in a standard integral and you do the saddle point approximation, these constants here will be fixed by your choice of quantum.
Exactly. So in quantum filter, usually we have real slice or some first given, God-given choice of contour, and therefore that's the additional information.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, if you know how to define this non-perturbative, you will find some way of going from here to here. That depends on the problem. Sometimes you have to be. So maybe if in the time I have left, what I would like to do is give you some sort of recent examples of this, you know. So I want to revisit two things, two examples, one in quantum mechanics and another in string theory. Yeah? Sure.
In this statement over here, you've really got in mind, you know, to go well beyond Borel summation to sort of K-summation and multi-summation as well.
Yes.
And also, in this F here, would you expect the space of C's to be infinite dimensional once you go beyond the ODE picture or not?
Yeah, I mean, in principle, you know, for example, if this is not, it's clear that in the ODE picture, if I impose this asymptotic condition, this is a one-parameter problem, and this is where C's stay in for here, right? Now, it turns out that in many problems in quantum, even in string theory, you know, this answer is sufficient to reconstruct your answer here. But as I said, you know, in general, you might have, first of all, you might have a multi-instanton problem in the sense of having different instanton sectors. Here I'm assuming that there is one single instanton sector parametrized by a single C. But you have a different instanton sector, which is very often the case, then you know you will have to have here C1, C2, and you know you will have to have a much more complicated structure. So there will be more constants in the game. You have a higher order ODE, you will also have to consider higher.
There are the examples of the high rank, the or product of gauge groups. Each will have its Q.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So you will have many Qs depending what is your gauge group.
Absolutely.
So basically counted by Chern class.
Yes. Absolutely. So this is just this is just to kind of not to complicate my notation. So let me now discuss two recent examples in which these techniques have been applied. So so let me mention that it might happen that the value of C that you have to use in this story is zero. Okay. Is there some sort of pole that I have to use? Here. Okay. So it might happen that the value of C that you have to choose here is zero. So for example, in the original example I started with, which is the quartic oscillator in quantum mechanics, it's known that just by doing choosing C equals zero means that here just the perturbative series is enough. And this is what happens in the example of the quartic oscillator I started with. It's known from the work of Simon and Graffi and Grecki that in order to reconstruct the ground state energy of the quartic perturbation of the harmonic oscillator, it's enough to do Borel resummation of the perturbative series. There are no singularities in the real axis, so you can just do, S plus and S minus are the same. So for the quartic oscillator, it's a very simple case of semi-classical decoding. I mean, the quartic, you take C plus minus is equal to zero, and you have a very simple case of semi-classical decoding. The simplest case of semi-classical decoding is when the original non-perturbative quantity, exact quantity, can be recovered just by Borel resummation of the perturbative series. And this happens so often, but not always. So for example, for the double well oscillator is no longer the case. The double well oscillator, you have to use a non-trivial transseries. And of course, every time you have to use lateral Borel resummations, you will have to have a non-trivial value of Z. Okay? So that's, but in some cases, you know, semi-classical decoding is very simple. Okay, so let me give you, I don't have much time left, but let me give you an example in quantum mechanics. So, which is the, so this is something very well known, which is the WBKB expansion. So, let's assume that you have, let me start with a standard thing. So let's assume that you have a standard quantum mechanical Hamiltonian. So I put the mass equal to 1/2 to save a little bit of time. So what is the WKB method tells you? The all orders WKB. The all orders WKB method tells you that there is a simple differential. So you take, you consider the classical curve defined by this equation. So this defines function p of q up to a sign. So you have a non-trivial differential here, and the WKB method actually gives you a series of differentials. And then, let's assume that this Hamiltonian has a discrete spectrum, as before. So let's assume that we have a confining potential, as it has been the case in all these examples. So you can actually compute a perturbative series in H bar, in H bar square, out of these differentials. So essentially as follows. If you have your potential, you have your constant energy. So this defines a cycle on this curve. So let me call this the B cycle for historical reasons. And then what the WKB method tells you is that you can construct a perturbative series in the energy, which only involves the even differentials here. The others give you trivial contribution. So, and let me call this the perturbative quantum volume, which is a function of A and H bar. So this is a formal power series in H bar, where each coefficient here is a function, let me call it An, a function of the energy. So this is interesting because, in contrast to simple series in quantum mechanics, this is a parameter series. So it's a series in H bar, but each coefficient is actually a highly non-trivial function of the energy. And actually, this is called the perturbative, I call it the perturbative quantum volume, because the first term, A0 of E, is actually the integral of P dQ over the B cycle, which is the classical available volume in phase space. So WKB method defines a formal power series in H bar, and the reason why this power series is important is because this can be used to find a semi-classical approximation to the spectrum. Right? So
lambda and mirror morph.
Yeah, they are mirror morphic.
And is it the compact curve? I mean, is there a genus?
Yeah, of course there is a genus, yeah.
But you only have one B cycle.
I mean, in this case, you know, of course there are many cycles in the complex space, but you know, you want to consider the perturbative. Actually, Andre is a world expert on this. He can tell you everything about this. But if you want to consider the perturbative approximation to the volume, in this case in which you have a confining potential, this is the only cycle that intervenes at the perturbative level. Now the question is, when you consider precisely the transseries related to this object, you will have to consider all other cycles in this Riemann surface, not only this one. This is, I will only hint at this.
When you say volume, you mean in the phase space below the energy E?
Yeah. This is the volume of the region with energy less or equal than E in phase space. Okay, that's, this is just a name to name this quantity, because this quantity, actually, it's very interesting because this quantity doesn't have, as far as I know, there is no non-perturbative definition of this quantity in spectral theory. So WKB defines this quantity, but as far as I know, there is no exact generic definition of this volume of volume of this volume function, which is a function of h bar in quantum mechanics. That's a very interesting thing. And actually, André knows a lot about this because in his paper with Balian and Parisi in 1978, they actually pointed out this. They actually said, you know, we use this function all the time because, why we use this function? We use this function because the generalized Bohr-Sommerfeld quantization condition tells me that this perturbative function is equal to 2p h bar m plus, say, k plus 1 half, where k is the quantum number. And this defines a formal power series which is, again, of this type, as a function of the quantum number. But so we use this formal volume function all the time as a formal power series, but there is no exact definition of a volume function in quantum mechanics.
For some potentials, there is.
Yes, I know that. But there is no, it's not like in spectral theory. I mean, in spectral theory, you know that if I give you the Hamiltonian, Hamiltonian has a spectral properties. In this case, if the operator 1 over h bar is compact, 1 over the Hamiltonian is compact and so on, you have defined non-perturbatively a series of level energy. But this function, there is no procedure to compute it.
Well, there is something that generalized beta ansatz where, in fact, that's what you are constructing.
Yes, yes. That's one of the things that I'm going to...
So I would propose to them for all algebraic integrable systems.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. But that's but there is no general definition of this in general. Okay, so I give you an arbitrary potential, an arbitrary Hamiltonian, even in one dimension, it's not so easy to compute this function. So the question now is then if one can actually define, you know, is there a way of defining this? In maybe in some cases, and if is so, is there a semi-classical decoding for this function? Because this is precisely the kind of situation in which semi-classical decoding is important, in the sense that we have the perturbative part. In some cases, we might have an exact definition of this. So the question is posed, can we actually find a completion of this perturbative series to a trans series such that this Borel resummation gives you the exact volume? And actually, as you were pointing out, there are some cases in which this is the case, but as far as I know, there is no general statement about the semi-classical decoding of these exact functions. So for example, to refer to the work of Sanson, for this potential, for example, you can define an exact volume function, but as far as, and of course, this volume function, exact volume function, has this asymptotic expansion, but it's not obvious that how you would reconstruct this exact volume function with resurgence using semi-classical decoding. Okay, this is something that has not been completely done. Okay, but so you see that already in quantum mechanics, the principle of semi-classical decoding, once you go beyond energy levels and so on, is interesting, and precisely in that type of problems in which you have series, formal power series, in which the coefficients are themselves functions of another parameter, say like the energy. So this is that, these are actually two parameter problems. For these two parameter...
In this case, the answer in A bar is exact and expansion is in the C, what you call C.
Right, but
convergent expansion...
Absolutely, yeah, but this is the exact definition of volume. But the question is, for example, there is one example that André studied, in which, for example, which is not so different because, you know, this also has no, you know, this also has no just two turning points and nothing else. In this problem, the trans-series structure of this volume function is actually quite non-trivial, right? As André studied. So it's not obvious, you know, what is, I mean, it would be interesting, I think, to kind of find some semi-classical decoding for this type of integrable models in which you have an exact volume function, okay? The same way that, And Andre has its own approach to this, based on the volume function as the solution to a fixed point equation, right? Which is slightly different from here because you need parity to actually, you have two different functions defined by parity. But again, you know, these are examples in which already in quantum mechanics, which seems to be a very kind of well understood system in which there are still many interesting questions in which new results, new non-perturbative results, actually open again the question of semi-classical decoding in a non-trivial way. And now in the 5 minutes that are left, I just want to mention, of course, string theory. Also, Ricardo will talk about the string theory in some detail. But now in string theory, we have, in a sense, a similar situation to what happens in quantum mechanics for this volume function, because we don't have non-perturbative definitions of this of quantities. So let me mention just 5 minutes topological string theory. So again, I'm going to consider a simplified version. So I'm going to consider topological string theory. So X is going to be a Calabi-Yau threefold. Also, in most of my cases, in most of the examples, I'm going to take X to be toric. So we can do a lot of progress here. So in topological string theory, you define a formal power series for the closed string sector, which is, again, this is purely formal. And you see, it's not so different from the quantum volume in the sense that, oops, I already erased that, sorry. In the sense that you have a power series in GS. GS is called the string coupling constant. But each coefficient is itself a non-trivial function of the moduli of the Calabi-Yau. So again, I'm just considering a simple case in which the Calabi-Yau has a single modulus. This is the string coupling constant. But of course, this extends straightforwardly to the most general case. So topological string theory actually produces this for you. And we know, for example, in the case of toric Calabi-Yau manifolds, there is a very systematic way of constructing this function as a function by using, for example, the topological recursion. Or you can think about, you can compute this by using a large radius in the large radius point of Calabi-Yau threefold by using Gromov-Witten theory and so on. But the question is that this series is also factorial divergent. So it's known that these quantities diverge like 2G factorially. And this is one of the reasons why string theory, in particular topological string theory, are not defined at non-perturbative level, because the only thing you get from the Polyakov definition or from genus expansion is this formal power series. Now, the question is, there are like two questions here. The first one is, can we promote this to a well-defined function? And second, if we can promote this to a well-defined function, has this function a semi-classical decoding in which you get this as the perturbative series and then maybe other trans-series terms? And this is very interesting because we know that topological string theory gives you a lot of geometric information over the Calabi-Yau manifold X. So if there are non-trivial trans-series involved here, we are opening the way to having new sectors of string theory which might contain very interesting information about this Calabi-Yau. We know that these quantities essentially count Wolschitz instantons, but maybe you find a transserious object, generalizing this object, the transserious will count, maybe will have some enumerative content, and we may be able to count some objects in this Calabi-Yau manifold. Okay? So there was a lot of work in the recent years in trying, first of all, already to define transserious for this object. And for me, the most successful attempt to do that was the paper by Couso, Santa Maria, Schiappa, and collaborators. And what they did was very clever. What they did was to use the BCOV equations, a set of what are called the holomorphic anomaly equations. So the holomorphic anomaly equations, the nice thing that they have is that they are recursive. They have a recursive structure. So every time you have a recursion, you can try to enlarge the recursion to an ansatz of the form of a transseries. And they were able to find formal transseries extensions of these quantities in general, the only price they have to pay is the same price that you pay with the holomorphic anomaly equation of VCOV, that this didn't really define the FGs or the transitive extensions, but they define them up to a holomorphic ambiguity. But modulo that, they were able to actually do this. And so this paper gives a transitive, formal transitive construction.
What is the meaning of C?
What?
With the instanton counting parameter, what is it in this case? There has to be another parameter for
yes, this. Yes, 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 yes.
So what is
it? Yes. Well, that's actually for me, it's essentially an open question. What is the geometric meaning of this transitive? Yeah.
There is no parameter in this theory. Well, the parameters are already there. You have moduli, you have three coupling constant, what else?
No, but this also in quantum field theory, you know. Instantons also involve just
calculable. If you have an action, then
yes, yes, but here we don't have a string field theory action to do that. Exactly.
String field theory defines C.
Absolutely. But then, you know, what you can do in the absence of a string field theory, you can try to see how much the perturbative structure you already know tells you about this. And what is nice about transitive is that even if you don't know what is the organizing principle behind a string theory, you can still compute using this sort of formal methods, you can compute a formal transitive. I'm not saying that we know everything about this formal transitive, but at least now we have some tool to compute it. And this tool produces concrete things. And one of the beautiful things that they did was, for example, to check that these transitives actually control in extreme beautiful detail the large term behavior of these quantities. So this is the first test that you have to do when you want to understand the transitive. I guess Ricardo is going to tell us more about this. So here we have at least the ingredients for a semi-classical decoding. And I guess Ricardo will also tell us more about this in the sense that we now have at least some sort of non-perturbative definition of this quantity using essentially quantum mechanical models and spectral theory. And again, the question is posed of how can you relate a non-perturbative definition of this guy to this formal transitive, and Ricardo, I guess, will tell you more about this. But this is just to show you that these tools of resurgence, which go back to the very elementary aspects of quantum mechanics, have been extremely useful to understand problems, at least to make some concrete progress in problems which seem much harder, which is, for example, what is the non-perturbative structure of string theory. And although there have been many attempts to solve this problem, the people who work in resurgence, like me, what we wanted to do was to follow the advice of Toft. When Toft was looking at renormalons, he said we had to use as much as possible the information contained in perturbation theory. And resurgence is in a way doing that. Use as much as possible the information in perturbation theory to try to see what is beyond perturbation theory. And transitives are a way to formalize this. And in the case of string theory, there was an actual progress in understanding concretely these sectors beyond perturbation theory using the tools of transitives, but of course many problems remain, and I hope that in the future there will be also some answers to these problems. So let me stop here.
From the point of view of identifying these two geometric engineering and the unknown theory, if you calculate that, there is a meaning of Q, because in a gauge theory there is Q.
Yes. You mean C?
Yeah. This. So is that Q coincides with the C of...
No, because you see, when you do geometric, when you try to use... It's true that this is related to information in supersymmetric gauge theories in some sort of... Yeah. But these extra ingredients are not part of Cyber-Witten story, so as far as I know. No. Because the instanton information of Cyber-Witten theory tells you walled instanton information in topological string theory. So it's not telling you space-time information in topological string theory. So space-time information in topological string theory is also new from the point of view of the Cyber-Witten connection.
But I remember you personally did reconstruct non-perturbative answer from the Ibert-Witten with one epsilon, right? You had claimed that you wrote a non-perturbative completion.
Yeah. Using this quantum mechanical model of this topological string theory, you can reconstruct, for example...
What is then the C there in your reconstruction? You can tell us probably.
Well, this has not been there is no, it's still not clear what how you semi-classically decode this and what is the geometric information in this. I can write for you this trans series. Now, that's, I think, for me, one very important question.
Q is, that C is fixed.
Yeah. This C is fixed, exactly. This C is fixed by my definition. But even in simpler cases, you know, let's take 2D gravity. Let's take pan level 1. Pan level 1, you know that the coefficients of pan level 1 of this perturbative series have interpretation as some sort of intersection numbers in the moduli space of curves. Now take the trans series solution to pan level 1. Have these coefficients there some interpretation in terms of intersection theory with boundaries or something like that? I mean, even in that case, which is much more elementary, I don't know at least what is the if there is a geometric interpretation for this trans series. And this is a context in which this series has a geometric meaning, you see, as a non-critical string theory. So,
In the quantum mechanical case on the left-hand side,
yes,
you will have a beta equation. Lambdas will be quantized, right?
Yes.
You don't have to put it, but in a
absolutely
way, okay,
yeah.
Lambdas, but in the topological string,
yes,
there is no reason for
absolutely
lambdas to be quantized.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
From the left-hand side, I would say that in things I understand, there is a way to go off shell.
Yes.
It's not unique. And the right-hand side, it's always off shell.
Yeah, but let me point out, this is actually what André remarked in 78, because he was saying the volume function, you see, it's quantized as well, because K is quantized. So this only defines E for a single, you know, but if you have the exact volume function, this defines the volume function for all values of E. So how is this possible? So when you have an exact definition, you might have a way of going beyond this discretization which the quantum mechanical structure imposes. So in some cases, actually, even in this quantum mechanical definition, it's true that in a first approach, you have to quantize lambda, but then you can go beyond that and write a general answer.
Physical is only quantized. So physical thing is only...
Yeah, but this is... But this is like in large-end dualities where, you know, every time you have like a, you try to construct a string theory with a gauge theory, you know, gauge theory is discretized because the rank of the gauge group is an integer, and then you know that this should give you a geometric parameter in space-time. So it's always the same problem here. It's not different, and it's also the same problem in the WKV formula of the volume. So that's always the case. Okay.